We will look at the concept of economic development and economic growth, their distinctions, their natures, their characteristics, their evolution. Economic development is a complex term. It refers to a country's concerted use of its natural and human resources so as to attain a high level of national and per capita income and reduce, if not remove, hunger, malnutrition, inequality, poverty, unemployment, and other such economic maladies. What is the word from which it comes? It comes from the French word developer, which means to unfold. So economic development means the general unfolding or blossoming of a country's prospects towards what? Towards tangible material improvement, material welfare. So economic development is not just a matter of the level of achievement, but rather the progress or the movement towards it. It is an ongoing process rather than a static final state. No country, however rich or advanced, and can ever be said to have reached a perfect or ultimate state of economic development. It can always go further or it can fall down. So economic development is ultimately a process and not a state. Even when substantial material welfare has been achieved, there are degrees of development to be achieved further. And this degrees of economic development has created some kind of a distinction or division or classification of the world. There are countries which are regarded as economically developed, developed countries, the Western countries, developed Western countries, and so on. And there are certain countries which are regarded as underdeveloped countries or less developed countries, LDC, UDC, DC. Take for example Sweden, USA, Canada, Britain, Germany, Singapore. These are countries which we would say belong to the DCs or developed countries or advanced economies. India, China, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Tanzania, Uganda, Zambia, such countries used to be called underdeveloped or less developed countries. Nowadays we use the term developing economies or developing countries to indicate that they are not underdeveloped only, but they are underdeveloped and yet they are moving towards higher development. So they are participating in the process. So they are also part of the development process. They are not just static, they are participating. So they are developing rather than underdeveloped countries. Countries with economic development, as I just mentioned, are also called advanced countries or rich countries, and countries with lesser degrees of development are sometimes also referred to as backward countries or poor countries and so on. It is actually better to be very judicious in the use of the word backward, poor, etc. and so on, because the nature of development is such that things change, and a developed country of today can very well become less developed another time and so on. An underdeveloped or developing country can get to the top and become one of the world's most advanced or economically developed countries. Now, because of this, the International Monetary Fund, IMF, has said that it is better to be judicious in the use of these terms, and although we can make a classification, we can say that 65.8% of global nominal GDP and 52.1% of global GDP in 2010 do belong to United States, Japan, France, United Kingdom, Italy, and such other developed countries. Nevertheless, we do find that other countries are also coming up. the poorest countries, nations which cannot be regarded as developing and belong to the poorest subset, are called less economically developed countries.
After studying this module, you shall be able to know what economic development is, learn what the characteristics of economic development are, identify what the features of underdevelopment are, evaluate whether a country is economically developed, and analyze what factors lie behind development and underdevelopment. Let us start by understanding the term economic development, which refers to a country's concerted use of its natural and human resources so as to attain a high level of national and per capita income and reduce, if not remove, inequality, poverty, unemployment, and other such economic maladies. It is an ongoing process rather than a final state. The world consists of countries or economies with varying degrees of economic development. Developed countries, industrialized countries, or a more economically developed country are countries with a highly advanced industrial and infrastructural position relative to other countries with lesser industrial and infrastructural achievements. Developed countries are characterized by a high level of national income and per capita income, along with a high standard of living, for example, USA and Japan. A developing country, also called a less developed country or underdeveloped country, is one with a less advanced industrial and infrastructural level, as well as a lower level of living standard and associated facilities. Such countries are in a transitional stage and may eventually join the ranks of developed countries. China and India are some such examples. The poorest nations, which cannot be regarded as developing and belong to the poorest subset of less developed countries, are called less economically developed countries, for example, the countries of sub-Saharan Africa.
Now we come to the very important distinction between economic development and economic growth. You see, generally, we tend to identify economic growth and economic development. But economic development has to be contrasted with economic growth. The two are related, naturally, they are very, very related, but the two are not just the same. Economic development is a wider or more comprehensive concept than economic growth. Economic growth, the term, comes from an old Norse word called grui or groa, which is to be healthy. If a person, you say that, okay, he's got good growth, that means he's a healthy person, growing person. So economic growth means that this particular country has achieved some increase in its material well-being, usually measured by national income. So economic growth is a concrete, quantifiable concept, whereas economic development has got other dimensions. It is not so easily measured. So far as economic growth is concerned, what we do is that we take a particular year's national income, compare it with, let us say, the previous year's national income, take the difference and take the proportion of that difference with the previous year's income. YT minus YT minus 1, this difference, you divide it by YT minus 1. So you get a proportionate idea of how much the growth in terms of Y or national income has happened. So this you can calculate whatever the rate is, 6.5%, 5.6%, it doesn't matter. This is a calculable thing. It doesn't have other dimensions than national income, let's say. But sometimes what you can find that a particular country which has got a high rate of economic growth, this coefficient, usually G equals YT minus YT minus 1 divided by YT minus 1. This may be quite high, but the people may be not very literate, the people may suffer from malnutrition, the people may be very deprived of natural economic freedoms. So that way you cannot call that country an economically developed country. Development is more than simply growing in terms of the national income. Economists Charles Kindleberger and Bruce Henrich have written, economic development includes improvement in material welfare, especially of persons with lower incomes, the eradication of mass poverty, illiteracy, disease and early death, change in life composition of inputs and outputs that generally include shifts in underlying structure of production away from agriculture towards industrial activities. The organization of the country in such a way that productive employment is general among the working age population than in the situation of privileged minority, and the correspondingly great participation of broadly based groups in making decisions about the direction, economic or otherwise, in which they should move to improve their welfare. That is, there is mass participation, there is movement collective towards a general improvement, decision making, deciding the country's future and so on. Unless you have this, even if you have a very high rate of G, you find that you cannot really say this country is economically developed.
Now we will focus on the distinction between economic growth and development. Economic development is a wider and more comprehensive concept than economic growth. Economic growth refers to the process of a country's achieving long-term and sustained increase in the national income. It is possible to define it in terms of national income and measure it in terms of a rate of growth. Whereas development has other dimensions than growth, it cannot be captured in terms of national income alone. According to eminent economists, development must be conceived of as a multidimensional process, including improvements in material welfare, especially of persons with lower incomes, and include shifts in underlying structures of production away from agriculture towards industrial activities, and is also defined as the ability to meet basic needs such as food, shelter, health, protection, and self-esteem, and freedom from servitude. Thus, economic development encompasses much more than economic growth. Let us now study about various characteristics of underdevelopment. They are low per capita income, predominance of primary sector, population pressure, chronic unemployment, malnutrition and illiteracy, low urbanization, low savings and capital formation, political instability, social rigidity, lack of dynamism, self-esteem and freedom, poverty, inequality, lack of food security, low development of market and monetization, inadequate and inefficient institutions and agencies. Now we will explain these characteristics individually.
Examples of those countries would be, let us say, sub-Saharan Africa. But even there, we cannot lose hope, and we always expect that these countries will come up in the future. A developing country, less developed country, underdeveloped country, etc., these are after all names. And as the United Nations Statistics Division has stated, these are statistical categories and should not be interpreted as a judgment upon the levels reached by specific countries. There is no judgment involved that this is backward and this is, poor and less. There is no value judgment involved. This is basically a statistical division.
Low per capita, that is per head income, is a major feature of underdevelopment. In 2005, the per capita gross national income of USA at purchasing power parity rate was ₹41,950, while for India it was ₹3,460, which shows a huge gap between developed and underdeveloped countries. It is per capita income that is relevant, not so much as the national income. Primary activities like agriculture, animal husbandry, and fishing predominate in underdeveloped countries. Secondary activities like industrial manufacturing and the tertiary activities like banking are relatively disadvantaged and less important. In India, about 58% of the labor force is engaged in agriculture, while in the USA, only 1% is so engaged. Underdevelopment is usually accompanied by the pressure of a vast and growing population. The birth rate in less developed countries is high, and the control of the death rate through better medical facilities only increases the rate of growth of population. Unemployment is a chronic malady of underdeveloped countries. Because the secondary activities do not grow fast enough, the fast-growing population becomes an increasing burden upon both rural and urban areas. The population of under and less developed countries is usually undernourished, rickety, and even marked by deformities. Literacy and skill formations are low and inadequate. Human capital, as labor is called, is deficient. In most of the under and less developed countries, urban development is low. Rural, that is, village areas predominate. Industrial activities, infrastructure, educational and medical facilities are inadequate. In underdeveloped countries, per capita income is low, and due to traditional ways of spending, the saving habit is lacking, and thus capital gets formed very slowly, which further slows down the overall rate of economic growth. The rate of human capital formation is also low in under and less developed countries. Underdeveloped and less developed countries are usually torn by political uncertainty, social divisiveness, old-fashioned attitudes and a diffident outlook. For example, the caste system and the joint family system, the belief in the philosophy of karma, beliefs like these obstruct the development process of a country. The lack of economic development keeps the masses in poverty, inequality, and insecurity about the availability of food. Economic development can be said to take place only if these aspects improve. By the Planning Commission's estimate, even at the turn of the century, about 26% of the total population in India is poor. Inequality of income as well as income-yielding assets, land and capital are also blatantly unequal in under and less developed countries. Insecurity regarding something as essential as food is another characteristic of under and less developed countries. By the turn of the 20th century, people in various parts of India still go hungry, and there are reports of starvation deaths as well as reports of rats gnawing at food grains stocked in the Food Corporation of India godowns. Underdeveloped and less developed countries lag behind the developed ones in the use of money and the functioning of markets. As markets develop and feudalistic life changes to capitalistic, the country becomes increasingly monetized. But in developing countries, this monetization process, including the buying and selling of shares and bonds, as well as of commodities and services, and the development of the share market and the stock exchange, are at an elementary level. The economic development of a country depends crucially on its institutions and agencies. In underdeveloped or less developed countries, these institutions and agencies are also underdeveloped. Let us now look at the causes of underdevelopment or backwardness. These are inadequacy of natural resources, overabundance of human resources, deficient in nutrition, education, and skill, low savings and capital formation, low monetization, market exchange, banking, and credit institutions, inadequacy of institutions and agencies, socio-political factors, like the vicious circle of poverty. Now we will discuss these causes individually. One major factor hindering economic development may be paucity of natural resources. Some developed countries have been blessed with an abundance of natural resources, and that has certainly aided their development process. But this is not a binding constraint to economic development. Britain and Japan, that lie under the category of developed countries, are only small island economies with no great abundance of land or mineral resources. Population pressure is one of the reasons why per capita income in underdeveloped countries tends to be low. Being the ratio of national income and the population of a country, per capita income falls as the rate of growth of population exceeds that of national income. While population in underdeveloped and less developed countries is usually vast, it is not abundant or adequate as a human resource, because it is marked by malnutrition and the lack of education and skill formation. The quality of human resource being relatively poor, its contribution to the national income is also relatively low.
Development must be conceived of as a multidimensional process involving major changes in the social structure, popular attitudes, and national institutions, as well as acceleration of economic growth, the reduction of inequality, and the reduction of poverty. Amartya Sen has also phrased it this way: economic growth is one aspect of the process of economic development. It is just one aspect, he says, that there are other aspects involved. So economic development, therefore, encompasses, includes much more than economic growth.
Low savings leads to low capital formation in underdeveloped and less developed countries. As capital is the mainspring of economic growth in the present era of capitalism, this is a major reason for lack of economic development. Wasteful consumption expenditure, for example, in weddings and funerals and religious rituals, even among the poor, is one important reason why the savings rate in underdeveloped or less developed countries tends to be low. Compared to developed countries, underdeveloped and less developed countries have a lower degree of monetization and market exchange. In several parts of, say, India and African countries, payments are still made in kind rather than in cash as part of custom or tradition. People still resort to local money lenders rather than banks for credit. In contemporary times, this is a big hindrance to economic development. Some underdeveloped countries are inhibited by lack of institutional support, such as a central planning and central banking system. Political instability, social rigidity, and old-fashioned diffident attitudes in people are other causes which keep an economy backward. Countries experiencing colonial rule or social oppression cannot respond to the challenges of economic development. The most serious cause of underdevelopment is the vicious circle of poverty that underdeveloped or less developed countries get caught in. What it means is that a country is poor because it is poor. Having a low national income, it has little ability or incentive to save. Low saving leads to low investment and low capital formation. These lead to low level of productivity per worker. Low productivity leads to low income generation. Low national income thus perpetuates itself. This observation still remains largely true. Breaking out of an underdeveloped state is very difficult.
Now, five-year plans in India have tried to achieve economic growth, but economic growth has also been sought after in the Indian economy through various other measures like the general educational process, promotion of medical facilities, and so on. So, a collective effort is very important in promoting economic growth as well as economic development. The Planning Commission, the erstwhile Planning Commission, because now we are talking of dismantling it, it is already standing dissolved. But it has made a tremendous contribution towards economic growth of India and also towards development, whereas economic development, once again, it has to be reiterated, is not a mere matter of the planning commission to achieve. It has to be achieved by the nation itself in very many other processes and other dimensions. Now, how has this concept evolved historically? I mean, what is this development process, economic development, etc.? To know this properly, we must look at the very title of Adam Smith's book. Adam Smith is regarded as the father of economics. He is the pioneering philosopher, shall we say, of economic development, of all economics. His book was named An Inquiry into the Causes of the Wealth of Nations. Again, see, he is looking at the wealth of nations, how nations, that is economies, develop wealth. The focus of economics has always been economic development. In that time, the 16th to late 18th century, this time was known as the mercantilist era. It was thought, especially in Europe — Europe is the place where mercantilist thought developed — that a nation's wealth depended largely on its stock of gold, silver, and other precious metals. It was the era of bullionism. Bullion means gold, silver, etc., precious metals in metallic form. So, development in mercantilist times meant development or accumulation of gold, silver, etc. Later on, in the 18th century, came physiocrats. These people, those, you know, previous philosophers and thinkers, believed that the nation's wealth really came from its agriculture. Feudalism was the prevailing economic system, and the physiocrats therefore found that economic development means more, you know, fruitful agriculture. Improvement of agriculture, that's what economic development is. But then came the Industrial Revolution. The 19th century, 20th century were the era of Industrial Revolution, first in Britain and then all Europe. So immediately we find that the concept of economic development changed. Now economic development meant industrial development, not agricultural development, or at least not agricultural development only. You had to be an industrial nation, an industrially developed nation, in order to be called a developed nation. Development meant industrial development, industrial growth. This is a very important change in the connotation or sense of economic. Then the world wars, the Great Depression of the 1930s, all these added to this idea. And especially after that, after the Second World War and so on, welfare aspects and various other dimensions of growing for a country came into picture, and people began to use the concept of development more. Development, rather than mere growth in terms of national income, came in the vogue of those times. And for example, the first five-year plan, which really started in the 1950s, independent India after the First World War and the achievement of India's independence, we find that the focus, they're not just using the words economic growth, the definition, let us say, which the first five-year plan of India puts is that an underdeveloped economy is characterized by the existence, in greater or less degree, of unutilized or underutilized manpower on the one hand and unexploited natural resources on the other. This state of affairs may be due to stagnancy of techniques or to certain inhibiting socio-economic factors which prevent the more dynamic forces in the economy from asserting themselves. So it is this dynamism, these socio-economic factors, which are coming into the very definition now.
In this module, we have learned about various characteristics of developed as well as developing or underdeveloped economies. We have also learned to identify the features or characteristics of economic development and the various causes of underdevelopment. Now, we also know the factors that lie behind development and underdevelopment in specific countries.